These are the setup instructions. So if you want to get that done, could I get a raise of hands, see who's done this and has maybe even run this check environment script? Okay. Are other people waiting on downloads? Is that the big thing? Okay. Is it cloning the repository that's taking the longest time? Very slow. Oh, no. It's not that big. I included one example that is, you know, it's got like a 15 meg file, so it's not terrible, but yeah. Oh, well, that's unfortunate. Okay. You say downloading the zip, was that quicker? Oh, well, okay, so GitHub does have this download zip option as well, which apparently might be faster. I guess I could also push this up to Git Bitbucket or something, split our resources, but maybe we'll just hang out for a second. I was hoping, so there's also the Spark tutorial going on as well, and then Luigi, I'm guessing, you know, they're big data applications, right? So I was hoping we could beat them, but apparently they're already killing the network. That's okay, though. So everyone's at least starting to download the repository, right? Okay. So maybe I've got a few things up front. Let these last few people get their clones started. And the first couple notebooks, there's actually not that much interaction, so maybe we can get started. Yeah, is there a question there? Okay, so I'll just go into my slides, very brief slides here. So again, my name's Tom Augspurger. I think I may have forgotten to say that. Name's Tom Augspurger, and this is the Pandas tutorial. Again, here are the instructions basically for getting going. Hopefully everyone's, or most everyone's started cloning the repository and are slowly getting there. A brief slide about me. I was in the University of Iowa economics program for a few years. That kind of led me to Pandas. That's where I first started learning Pandas. And I've been using Pandas for about 3 years now, just to help out with my research. And been a contributor to Pandas for a couple years now. And then for the last year, I've been working at Matera. I'm from Des Moines, that's where we're based, and basically doing, you know, data science consulting, that sort of thing. So the thing tying all three of these together is Pandas. We get to use a lot of Pandas, a lot of Python at Matera. So part of that's because it's a small place, and I got to impose my will of Pandas upon the rest of the people there. So that's good, I think. I think that's a good thing. The plan is pretty simple. We have notebooks, and I think I could actually scratch this project. We're probably not going to have time for the project, so I think our plan is just do the notebooks as soon as we're ready to go there. So I'm actually going to jump over to those now. Let's do a check. How is the download coming on the repository percentage-wise? I guess, does Git tell you? It doesn't tell you percent, does it? Who has finished downloading the repository? Oh, that's more, though. That's good. That's great. Awesome. I think, so this check environment script here, the check environment script here downloads one data set, one additional data set, which hopefully would go pretty quick. There's a couple seats here in the first two rows, one here, it's actually filling up. This is awesome. So one other thing I want to check is quick experience level. Where are people at? Who here has like maybe never used Pandas, never used the IPython notebook before? Okay, a handful. Awesome. That's actually really cool. So in the past week, I've marked it as an intermediate topic. And in the past week or two, I've really moved more towards the beginner / intermediate level. So this is good. Who here has would say they've used Pandas before? They've used NumPy. They're pretty familiar with it. Okay, and then experts, self-proclaimed experts in the room. I wouldn't even say I'm an expert in Pandas. It's a big library, unfortunately. Okay, that's good though. That's awesome. Okay, I think I'm gonna jump into the first notebook then. Time-wise, we'll get through what we can, basically. And then you have the notebooks if we don't get through. So, I should walk you through this. So this is the PyData. Oh yeah, I called my talk PyData. I shouldn't have done that because a lot of people are probably doing that. So you can rename the repository, that's fine. So if you change directory into that repository and then go into the notebooks, that's basically where we're gonna start everything from. So make sure you're in the PyData Seattle, which is what I called it, /notebooks, and then start your IPython notebook there. You can leave off this profile stuff, just need IPython notebook. I just wanted to make sure I had a clean profile so that I didn't mess anything up. Okay, so one more show of hands here. Who has gotten the notebook started up? Okay. Yes, I sure can. So if I can find it, it's here, if you can read that. That's a tiny URL. That'll take you to this GitHub page. Easier than spelling my last name. Is that visible in the back at all? Okay. Okay, let's jump on in. Okay, so I'm in the first notebook here. This is called, one basics. If you haven't used the IPython notebook, it's really cool. You're gonna have your mind blown by it. It's a really awesome piece of technology, now called the Jupyter notebook, but we'll go with IPython for now. So basically two things you need to know is that it's modal. So there's a command mode, which is what I'm in right now. And then there's an edit mode when you wanna edit the cells. So to move around, J and K, J to go down, K to go up, Vim style. If you want to enter edit mode, you'll just press enter. If you want to leave edit mode and go back to command mode, you hit escape. Okay, that's about all you need to know. One more thing. Shift enter is what actually executes a cell. And if you ever get confused, when you're in command mode, you can press H, keyboard shortcuts will pop up. I've hidden it here. There's also a toolbar up here. If you want to use that, if you feel better with that, that's fine. Okay, I think we'll get started then. So NumPy is the foundational library of scientific computing in Python. And so it's good to know a bit about NumPy, even if you're working at this higher level of Pandas. There will be times where you need to drop down to NumPy to do an operation, or there's some NumPy-isms that are good to know. So just running through here, the core of NumPy is the ND array, so an n-dimensional array. It's like a Python list in a sense, but there's a few big differences between NumPy array and the list. So NumPy arrays have a type, and that type is the type of every element in that array. So in this case, we have x.d type. This array is int 64. Okay. We can also have Booleans. So there's a whole bunch of different d types. You can see the chart here. The other thing, big difference, is that NumPy arrays are fixed size, so they have a shape. This case, y here is 2x2. Python lists, they're expandable. You can pop items off them. You can't or don't want to be doing that with NumPy arrays. Okay, so those are two big differences. The upshot is, so it might seem bad that you have a single D type or you have fixed size, but the upshot of that is a lot better performance generally. So that's the trade-off that you make. The other thing that you should know, two things from NumPy that you should know at the very least is, how to work with arrays, and then broadcasting. So broadcasting is just this basic idea that you can do operations between arrays of different sizes, as long as those sizes are conformable, is the word they use. So in this first case, we have x. It's just an array from 0 to 4, and then we add 1 to that. So we don't have to do anything to reshape the scalar 1 to be the same size as x. It just works, just like you would expect. Same thing, it's not limited to one-dimensional arrays. You can do it two-dimensional arrays, like y, we add 1 to it, it works out just fine. Okay. And then the awesome thing is operations between arrays work as well, as long as the, basically it has to be the last, the shape of the last dimension has to match up. So in this case, this is 5, it's just a one-dimensional array, x's, and then y is 2 by 5, so the last dimension matches, so we can do operations between them. Okay, any questions on that? It looked like this if you had to, you know, go through the hoops to make sure that arrays were the same shape before doing any operations, and you don't want to do that. Any questions on broadcasting? It'll come up in pandas, so that's why I want to introduce it now. We will get to pandas. We'll get to pandas now, actually. So pandas, it was built on top of NumPy, and it addresses some things that NumPy doesn't. NumPy is a fantastic library, and you should use it for a lot of things. But when you're doing kind of statistical stuff, pandas is really nice. Pandas gives you labeled arrays, so rather than, you know, indexing, slicing things by position, you're able to give those names, meaningful names. It's clear what you mean when you're writing the code. It's also easier to write that code. Labeled arrays are really nice. Heterogeneous data types within a table. So if we look back up here at, you know, y, this array here, the D type there is bool, and it's bool for the entire array. With pure NumPy, you can't have an array, you know, like one column be bools, the other column be characters, the other column be ints. You can't do that in NumPy. Pandas kind of gets around that, and it gives you, it lets you have a table with multiple data types, which is very useful in the real world. Missing data handling, another thing from the real world. Data, they're not clean. You're going to have missing data. NumPy does have some missing data support. Pandas adds on to that. More convenient methods, so as you're doing, you know, statistics, there's stuff that's going to come up, value counts, things like that. A lot of pretty good plotting in pandas as well, built into the data frame, which we'll talk about. And then more richer data types, like categoricals, statistical, in the statistical sense, better date time, things like that. So those are some things that pandas gives you on top of NumPy. And then the first introduction to pandas is always going to start with the data structures. I was going to try and do something different, but I think it's the appropriate place to start. So you have a data frame. A lot of languages are starting to implement these. R has had one for a while. Pandas is an implementation of the data frame in Python. So when you're, you know, there's a lot of ways to get a data frame. In this case, we'll just pass in a dictionary of column names to column values. So if we run that cell, you can see A is our column name, B, C, those are our column names, and then we have our row labels in this index thing. I'll be talking a lot more about that later, but yeah, schematically, again, you have column labels along the top, row labels along the side, and then the data in the actual middle of the data frame. So that's like the essence of a data frame. Again, moving fairly quickly through these, try not to get too bogged down in the details, but it's useful to be able to slice things. And again, pandas is giving you labeled arrays. So if you want to select a single column, you'll just use the pretty standard Python get item square brackets. So just like a dictionary, you pass in the key of the thing that you want to get. So if you want to select the column A, you select that, and it returns this. It's actually a series. It's like a one-dimensional analog to the data frame. I'll talk about that in a sec. You can also pass in lists of columns to the same square brackets, get items. So we select columns A and C. So that's column selection. If you want to do row selection, you're going to use the .loc or .loc. I'm actually not sure how it's pronounced. Basically saying, give me the rows where the label is A and B, A or B. Okay, and that selects out those two rows. If you want, if your row labels are ordered, which is typically a good thing, if you can manage that, you can use ranges for your slicing. And sometimes it'll be easier to slice by position, and in that case you want to use iloc. Okay, so I for integer is the mnemonic there. So .loc, the range here is inclusive on both sides, which is a bit weird for Python, but it's useful. When you're slicing with labels, it's a lot easier to be inclusive. But iloc is open on the right-hand side, so we don't get the, you know, the third item included there. Okay. You can combine a row indexer and a column indexer. So in this case, we select the row label A, since we're using .loc, and then the column label B. So it goes row indexer, comma, column indexer. One thing to notice is that pandas will reduce the dimension of what you get back. So up above, we saw we selected a single column. We got back a series, which is a one-dimensional thing. Here, we select the single row and the single column, so we get back a scalar. Okay, and yeah, it's pretty fancy. Indexing is, you know, it's a tricky topic to get right. The code to handle it is tricky. But it's, yeah, you can get pretty fancy and do basically do what you need to do. Okay, so the summary here is, you know, just regular square brackets for selecting columns, .loc for index label selection, and then .iloc for positional selection. Okay, so how are we doing so far? Any questions on that? Yeah. So indicate, and what do you want to do with that?
Well, so you said, I mean, you had to add this index.
Yes.
And so, if you're reading in some data,
yes.
Like, you may not actually.
Yep. We'll see that in the next example. It's a, like if you're reading in from a CSV, you'll just say index underscore call equal name of the column. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So it's always going to have one by default. The index will be 0 through n minus 1, the length. So you always have one. You may not need it. Any other questions? Yeah.
So we use iloc for indexing in the rows. Is there a thing, similar thing for indexing in the columns?
Positional, you're saying? So what I would do there is df.iloc. Say I want every row with the colon here. And then if I want the first one, I'll do 0. I think, so this, I think, is this what you're asking? By position. Yeah, so you'll basically reuse the .iloc, and you'll just say, give me every single row with the colon here. It says, give me every single row of the first column. Okay, yeah, so there's not any special thing for that. If you do df of 0, you should get a key error. Yeah. Okay. Colon says, give me everything in that row. Yeah. Say again? Correct. Because then it'd be confused whether you're saying, I want the, if you just do, yeah, so the question was, do you need the colon? And if you just do df.loc 0, you know, it'll give you a key error. Comma 0 should be a syntax error. Yep. So you do need the colon to specify that. Okay. I think we're here. Any other questions? Okay. So series, we talked about data frame. That's a two-dimensional, it's a table, in-memory table. So pandas is in-memory, which is potentially important, but it's good for medium-sized data sets. Series is the one-dimensional, kind of analog to the data frame. They come up, so you know, when you select a single column, you get back a series. And again, here's an example of selecting everything. Every row, single column. And one final thing I should say is there's this very convenient dot attribute lookup. So basically, pandas will attach columns into the as an attribute on the actual data frame. So df here is the data frame. We've attached the A column onto the kind of the data frame namespace. This is really convenient. You might not want to use it in like production code or anything like that because you know, there's a lot of methods on a data frame. If you had a column called like mean or something, this is a function, a method on the data frame. So it can be confusing whether you're referring to the method mean or the column mean. So you want to be careful there. Assignment, when you're trying to like, if I wanted to add a new row, add a new column or overwrite the existing column A, you definitely don't want to do this because it's unclear whether you're saying attach the list 1, 2, 3 as an attribute called A to the data frame, or you're saying I want this new column called A with the name A, and it should contain the values 1, 2, 3. So if you're adding a new column, you'll want to use the square brackets or dot loc. That's just a quick aside there. Okay, and then the index. So we've talked about data frame. Yeah, your question.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll actually run through it. So I've added this mean column here. If I do df.mean, it's going to go with the method. Okay, so I can call that. It's actually, if you do the dot lookup, it's going to be the mean. And then if you do want to get that actual column, you'll just use the square brackets. Okay, good question. Okay. Yes, so we talked about data frames, talked about series, and now we have the index. So they're similar. Okay, so they're similar to row labels in R, if you're familiar with R. They're more powerful than row labels. They're a lot more complex than row labels are in R. They are not like indexes in SQL. They're not there to speed up your queries or anything like that. They're a separate object, and they're all about slicing. They're all about selecting row labels. Okay. We're going to talk a lot more about indexes. You can access them with the .index attribute. Every data frame, every series has an index. And there are different kinds of indexes, which are nice for depending on what you're doing, what kind of data you have for your index. We'll see multi-indexes. We'll see date-time indexes. These two we might not get to. So they're a tricky topic. Wes McKinney was the author of Pandas. And he's mentioning they are fantastic. Sometimes, most of the times even, but sometimes they just get in the way. It's sometimes hard to know when they're getting in the way, so hopefully I can try and give you some intuition on how to get around them if they're in your way, but most of the time they're just so convenient that it's awesome to have them around. Okay. Questions? That's the first notebook we've made it so far. Has everyone actually downloaded the repo now? I'm getting shaking heads. That's good. Nodding heads. I have one shaking head. That's unfortunate. Do you need the URL?
No.
It's still the download. Okay. Well, I'm sorry. We start to get interactive about halfway through this notebook. So, okay. So I'm starting up the second notebook here, operations. So if you want to get that one open. Anyone having trouble starting the notebook? Okay. What's your problem? Sorry, I didn't mean that. What's that? I'm sorry, that came out wrong. What issue are you having with the? Notebook's not valid. Is it an error or is it a warning? Really? Anyone else having that? So I'm using IPython 3.2, which is version 4 of their notebook. So if you're on 3.2, it should be fine. I guess so it may not be backwards or future. The old IPython might not be future compatible. So if you have an older IPython, you might not be able to read the notebooks. So you could upgrade your IPython. Yeah. Yes. Nobody's said anything in the chat yet. Here's the URL again. If you are having installation troubles, maybe you could throw a message into the Gitter chat, and someone might be able to help. Probably not me, though. Okay. So I think we'll move on to the second notebook. Okay, and if you think you know this, you can skip down to, if you follow this, this link goes within the notebook, the applications link here. You can follow that on down and start playing with the actual data. I don't like artificial examples like we're doing here, but so after this half of the notebook, everything will be with real data, much better. Okay, so we'll do our imports here. Ufunks are another NumPyism that I didn't talk about, but short for universal function. And basically, the idea behind a ufunk is it operates on an array element-wise, which means that it can operate on any sized array. So they're very useful. Pandas data frame series, they also work with the ufunks. So just showing that here, we have a data frame, random uniform numbers, 3x3. Here you can see the default index is 0 through 2, same for the columns. So add, addition is a ufunk. Exponentiation, numpy.log, numpy.exp, sine, cosine, all those are ufunks, and they all work on data frames just like you'd expect. So you don't have to worry about that. Alignment is something that's a bit different with pandas because it has to do with indexes. So we make a couple data frames here, DF1 and DF2. Different numbers. One thing to notice is that DF1 and DF2, they have the same index and they have the same columns. So when you do an operation between them, it just works like you would expect, right? So now we're going to do something. We're going to change the order of df2. So it's going to be the same, just arranged differently. So the row labeled 2 is still associated with 6 and 9, just like it was up here. 0 is still associated with 2 and 1. So I'll just change the order. Now when we do df1 plus df2 here, we get back the same result. So that means we've reordered the data frames. When we did that operation, we reordered them to align on the labels. Everyone see that? So we get the same numbers. Even though df2 is now ordered differently, we get the same answer. It's because we're realigning. We can have a different index entirely. So now df3 has these extra rows here, 3 and 4, and an entirely new column, c. When we do an operation between df1 and df3, inside the common subset of indices work as you would expect, just adding them. And then NANs, missing numbers, not a number, are filled in, I guess, in the where the two indices didn't overlap. Okay, so you get missing values there, which may or may not be what you expect, but it takes the union of the indices, it aligns on indices, and then does the operation. So any questions on that? Okay. So this, yeah, it's a fake example, so it's kind of hard to see maybe why it's useful, but we'll get there in just a second. So first application here is some time series. A few imports here to get things going. Hopefully everyone has stats models installed, is in the environment. Seaborn, it's a plotting library we'll be using quite a bit. Make this a bit bigger. Okay, so earlier I grabbed some data from Fred. Pandas has this data reader for web, basically downloading stuff from websites. Fred is one of them, Yahoo Finance is another. We've recently split that off into its separate package, but for now the API is the same between the two, so you can use either of these. We're actually gonna use neither because I've included these CSVs in the repo, so I just grabbed these earlier and then wrote them out to a CSV. We have three series, one for GDP, gross domestic product, one for CPI, which is like inflation, and then a US REC, which is an indicator for whether the US is currently in a recession. So that one's just 0 or 1. Okay. The files look like this. If you're on Windows, this may not work. I think it's like more or something. But in IPython, if you have an exclamation mark, it goes out to the shell. So looking at the first 10 lines of data.gdp, we have a date, and we have the GDP values here. So two columns, sorry. Pandas read CSV is what you want to do for reading in CSVs. It's got quite the function signature. I think last I checked, there are 55 parameters, maybe, which is a lot. But it's really useful to be able to do quite a bit of the data munging right at import, or just when you're reading in the data. So we'll use just a few of these today. In this case, so if we just look at the first one, reading in CSV for the GDP, we say index call is going to be date, so there's a question earlier about that. Read in date as the index, and then parse dates. So this takes a list of columns that you want to treat as date times, and it'll parse that correctly. And then the squeeze here just says, read CSV is always going to return a data frame. We have an index and then a single column, so I squeeze it down into a series. So that's all squeeze is doing. Questions on reading this in, or reading these in? We have three. Yeah. Yeah, so the question was, why do I pick date instead of just leaving date as a column and having 0 through whatever? It's going to be because of when we do operations between these three series here, we want them to align correctly, and the indexes are what help us align. So we'll see that. Okay. So looking at the series here, I guess, dot head, who here got the pun? The title's a pun, actually. So dot head gives you first five rows, and then GDP dot tail. So that's pandas, head to tail. There you go. I thought it was funny. We have CPI as well. And then REC, we can see, is the recession indicator, 1 and 0. Okay. So there's a few methods on data frame series to kind of summarize what's in the table. Describe wraps up a bunch of them, actually. You get count, mean, min, max, a few quantiles. Those methods are all available individually on the series or data frame as well. So just calling them, you can get the mean, standard deviation, all of that. Well, there's even more, kurtosis and all that. One additional thing that we use later on is IDX max, or is like the arg max. This is saying, give me the index label where the maximum occurred. So for GDP, the max value was this, 1700. The place where that max occurred was 2013, October 1st. Okay. Plotting, we'll get to the interactive stuff just after this, I promise. So pretty decent plotting capabilities on the data frame. It uses matplotlib under the hood. Actually, don't really worry about this code. I just wanted to make sure we had nice recession bar indicators on our graphs, like you should for any economic time series. So that's all that this stuff is doing, is finding, you know, give me, this is a PyTools function saying split it up by into basically recession versus non-recession. Filter out the non-recessions because we only want bars during the recessions, and then the span, so we go from the start of the recession to the end of the recession. And then I take those spans and draw recession bars, so nothing too panda specific there. But yeah, we can get this decent looking plot for GDP, CPI, looks like that. So we'll jump into our first exercise now. So CPI, consumer price index, the index just says that some arbitrarily chosen point in time is set equal to 100 and everything else is measured relative to that. So going back to Econ 101 for some of you maybe, let's say we want to change the base here. So this is like base 1982 to 1984, I think. So let's say we want to change the base year from that to 2009. So we want to measure everything relative to 2009. So this is your first little task here, is to take, see if you can divide, transform this CPI series from base 1982 to 84 to base 2009. The two steps there, I've kind of written that out, or three steps, is selecting just the rows for 2009, taking the average of those, and then dividing the entire CPI series by that average. So that's kind of how we would make the transformation there. One thing, so this is a time series. We have a date-time index. I should show you that. So we have CPI.index. It's a date-time index. It's one of the special indices we talked about, or I mentioned earlier. With that, so you might have to do something like, you know, CPI.loc, and then, you know, do the datetime.datetime for the first one all the way through the end. Time series are special just since it's so convenient to be able to do this, and that'll give you just the labels that are within 2009. Okay, so take a minute or so to try and do this first exercise, and then you can check your solutions here by running the next cell. There are any questions before we start with that? Okay, yeah, just a minute or so. And then make sure to assign the result to CPI09 because we'll use that later on. There's one message in the chat. There's also an image. I was wondering how many GIFs we would get in here. Nice. I am using Python 3 for this. It should be compatible with Python 2 as well, I hope. Okay, so I think we'll move along. So what that solution looks like, selecting just the years, the months for 2009. And then calling the mean function on that. So that's just going to be our average. Base 09 is just a number. So this is the average of the index before 2009. And then we make the transformation by dividing the original series by the base. So any questions on that? Okay. So now we have a base 2009 CPI. We can plot that if we'd like. And what we use that for is to make our adjustment to real GDP. So we have GDP, it's measured in dollars. You may not want to compare GDP, nominal GDP, so that's our unadjusted for inflation. You may not want to compare that between 2 years that are pretty far apart because of inflation. A dollar in 1980 is different than a dollar today. So you want to use real GDP in one way. Paving over some details. Real GDP, you can just take GDP and divide by the consumer price index. One problem that we would have if we didn't have our nice index labels is that the series are different lengths, and they're also measured at different frequencies. So GDP is measured, I think, quarterly, and then CPI is measured monthly. If we didn't have the nice capabilities of pandas, we would need to filter down. So this is Boolean indexes, which we'll get to in the next notebook. But this is basically saying, give me, you know, the months that are, you know, basically every third month, every fourth month here, and where the index year is less than 2014. So this is saying, you know, trying to get the values, the row labels from CPI that match GDP, since that's measured every third month, and then doing the operation. But in pandas, you don't need to do that. You just do your operation, and it works. You get missing values, which you may not want. If you have missing values, there's a few ways to deal with them. Pandas has methods for detecting them. So isNull will give you a Boolean series. If it's missing, it's true. If it's not missing, it's false. Filling, you can fill them with, fill in A takes quite a few different ways that you can do that. You can fill it with a value. You can fill it with a strategy, like fill forward, to take the last valid observation and go forward. Or you can drop them, which is what we'll do here. So just running this drop in A is a common point of confusion. People will do that, do drop in A, and then go on down their analysis and look at their variable and see that there's still missing values there. So pandas methods are all, or almost all, non-mutating by default. That means when you call a method, it doesn't mutate the method that it's being called on, the data frame that it's being called on. Instead, it returns a new data frame with that operation performed. So our GDP still has the missing values. So if you want to capture that change, you can just assign it to a new variable. And in this case, I use the same variable name. Okay. Questions on that? So yeah. Yes. Can you speak up just a bit? Sorry. Yeah. Yes. Yep. Yep. So maybe not at when you're reading it in with CSV. You can tell the parser that, you know, this column C should be an integer or a float. And I think it'll raise an error if it gets to that character. So you'll be able to detect it. The other thing you can do is read it in as an object. So if you have a mix of integers, floats, and then that character, that'll cast it to an object D type, which is basically the fallback when it's saying, you know, I have a mixture, I can't do anything better than object. In that case, there's the method, or GDP, convert objects, which basically does what it says. You can tell it, I want to convert my numeric, so this is, you know, this object is, or this column is object D type, I want to convert it to numeric. And then it would catch that one. It would see, you know, everything but this one row is an int, so I'm going to cast this one to int and put a missing value there, which actually make it a float, but that's different. Okay, so there's options for that. Okay, and just because we have the data, I wanted to make a pretty plot here. Percent change, all that does is takes the percent change from one row to the next. So if we do GDP dot head here, this first, very first one here is the percent change 243 to 246. And it does that for every row. And then we plot it for both. So you can see all the recessions. Okay, questions on that? Where are we at here? Okay. All good? All right. Well, let's move on to our next notebook. Recaps. Basically, things work as you'd expect. Ufunks work, operations, align by label first, and then go ahead and work. Okay. Third notebook, indexing. If you want to go ahead and open that up. So this was the largest file, the file that we're going to be working with. And it's actually a subset. So Stanford has this data from beeradvocate.com. It's a big file with a bunch of stuff in it. And it's a very, you know, it's not a great format for disseminating data, but you know, we can parse it in between Python and Pandas. So this is what the data set looks like. This is one review here. And then we have a new line. And then we have our next review start. Okay. So you don't have this file. I only gave you a subset that I went ahead and pre-processed just because for time and size reasons. So just so you can see, one of the nice things about Pandas is that it's written in Python. And Python has really nice capabilities for processing big streams of text. So basically what I did was open up this file using, again, that PyTools partition by function. Where was I at? Partition by. So basically what that does is it looks through this stream here for new lines in this case. And each time it sees a new line or doesn't see one, it starts a new partition. We filter out just those new lines. So this gives us basically a bunch of reviews. For each of those reviews, we apply this format review function. All that does is splits on this separator here. So you can see this is kind of like a dictionary, kind of like JSON, but not quite. So we're going to make this a dictionary by splitting on this for each line and then stripping off some new lines and stuff and then passing that into a dictionary. Okay, so we had a giant blob of text. We have, in this case, we have reviews. Now we have dictionaries. And then we partition that into chunks of 1,000, basically. So this file wouldn't fit in memory. It's pretty big. So we partition it into basically chunks of 100,000 reviews each. Those 100,000 I can work on in memory. And I should say, this is Python 3, so this is all lazily done. I haven't actually read anything in yet. Filter out none, so this is just a, don't worry about this, partition pads with none at the end if it's not evenly divisible. Filter out those, and then make the directory. And then, so for each one in this review now, for each of these chunks of 10,000, we basically cast it as a data frame and then write it out to CSV. And then the as data frame, there's not too much, just some renaming of columns, making the columns look a bit nicer. Pass it into the data frame. And then we have to do a bit of handling of numeric stuff since we just have text right now. We're not going through like the usual CSV reader. We'll read in a CSV and it will infer the dtypes correctly. We just have a bunch of text here. So we have to as type those as numerics, basically. And then one more datetime column. So not just trying to show, it's not part of the tutorial, but basically that's what I did there. And then to actually select the subset, so it looks like it was just like a database dump, so it was completely unordered. I wanted to select out, a subset time-wise, basically I think between like 2009 and 2010. To do that, I used Dask, which is a really interesting project. It's for parallel or out-of-core computing, and it has a Dask.dataframe module that mirrors at least a subset of Pandas API. So when you read in this, basically this directory of CSVs here, it doesn't actually read them all into memory because they wouldn't all fit. Quantile is a method on Pandas data frame. So just like that, you can pass in and get the quantiles between 0.5 and 0.6. So I wanted about a tenth of the data set. This we'll talk about in a second. And then basically we'll see this later on in this notebook. This is just Boolean indexes. So give me the rows where the time is between the 50th percentile and the 60th percentile. So that's what I'm doing. So Dask does everything. It doesn't actually execute anything until you ask for it. So that's why I have to do this compute. Before you call compute, it's actually building up these Dask graphs, this is way too big to be useful, but basically what it's saying is, I'm going to do this for you when you actually ask me for it. And it's going to do everything in chunks. So, one chunk per CSV, one partition, I think it's called. And this is just calculating the percentile on each of those chunks and then combining them together to give you back the single number. And then you can also do that for this is the Boolean indexing, basically. So yeah, Dask is neat. This is not a tutorial on Dask, though. There is a tutorial on Dask, I think right after this one, by Matt Rockland. So if this interests you at all, then I would definitely recommend checking that out. Okay, so Boolean indexing, we saw that up above. Did we read in? I don't know if I ran this column. Let's read this in. Imports, and then read in that CSV. So one more option we haven't seen yet is compression. So you can read in gzipped files, one other type of compression, I think. I'm going to make this list here of review columns. So what we have here is the, so for each review, we have the ABV, which I think is like the alcohol content, a beer ID, brewer ID, beer name, beer style, and then these columns here, and then review taste are what the reviewer, so each row is a person left a review on this website of this beer. We have an identifier for the profile name, and then we actually have the full text of the review as well, and a timestamp. Okay, so that's what we'll be working with for the next couple notebooks, actually. Okay, so Boolean indexing, basically, the idea behind Boolean indexing is it's like a where statement in SQL, if you're familiar with that. So here we have, you know, if you just select the column ABV, so looking at this first column here, select the column ABV and show me the rows where it's less than 5. Okay, so that's all this is doing is give me the rows where it's less than 5. That returns a series of Booleans, true and false. And if you pass that into the square bracket get item like before, what this does is it filters down the original data frame to just those rows where this condition is true. So that's the basis of Boolean indexing. Give me the rows where this condition is true. Is that sounding good to people? Okay. So if you notice, we used just the square brackets, which is what you do for selecting columns, right? So it's a bit weird. It's just convenient to be able to do that. You can also use .loc if you prefer that. And then, so give me the rows where the ABV is less than 5. And I just want the beer style and beer review, beer over review over all columns. So you can do that with .loc. Okay. It can get pretty complicated if you want. So I want the ABV less than 5, and the time needs to be greater than this timestamp, so July 2009, or if the review is greater than 4.5, give me those rows. One thing you need to be careful with, you'll hit this problem. If I just did the rows where the ABV is less than 5 and the review overall is greater than or equal to 4.5, this is going to throw an error, basically. The problem being basically the order of operations. So this is doing a bitwise and in this case. And that has higher precedence than these comparisons here. This is an unfortunate for this use case, a bit of Python. So you need to wrap those in, parentheses. So you'll hit that at some point, and that's why. OK. I think we have an exercise, yeah. So here we're going to find the IPAs. So series have these really nice string methods. It has, I think now we do have every real Python string method on there as well. If you look at df.beerstyle.stir, there's a whole bunch of, if you hit tab, you can see all the methods here. Okay, these are implemented on series that contain text. So what we want to do here is find the rows where the beer style contains IPA. So go ahead and take 30 seconds to do that one. And let me know if you have any questions. Happy to answer them. Okay, how are people doing here? Do you have a sad panda? Sneezing panda. Ooh. Yeah, if you're having trouble with tables, that does require a C compiler, or you can use Conda or Anaconda, and it would just work for you. Okay, so this one, everyone able to get it, hopefully? So we're going to use this new function that we haven't seen before, but .stir.contains, that takes a string. So I want to know, is IPA is just going to be a series here of trues and falses, whether or not the beer style contains IPA. And then we'll use that as the indexer. So basically anything that returns an array of trues and falses is potentially an indexer, which is pretty powerful. Questions on that? Basically, because it helps with discoverability. If you know that you want to do a string operation, you know that they're all under this .stir namespace. Pandas data frames already have like hundreds of methods on them. If I just do df dot, you know, you can see this is, well, maybe you can't see, but that scroll bar is pretty big. There's a lot of methods on data frame. We also have like a date time namespace. Well, if we had I think df dot time. .dt has a few things under it. So this is something we've kind of been moving towards, is there's so many methods on the data frame that it is potentially easier if you know about strings, the .stir namespace or .dt namespace. It helps group things there. But you have to know about them first, unfortunately. So it's a trade-off there. But yeah, namespaces are good. Okay. So we've run that. Okay, so isin. So sometimes you don't care, you know, like before we had if it .stir.contains IPA. Well, what if we wanted to know about IPA or this other kind or this other kind? So isn can help with that. So we'll look at this. We select just this subset of columns that are related to brewers, brewer ID and beer ID. And then we look at the value counts of those. So I'll show you this. So df.brewer ID dot value counts does pretty much what you would expect. Counts the number of occurrences of each value. So in the index here, we have the brewer ID. And then in the values here are the number of times that brewer was reviewed. Same thing for, we do the same thing here for beer ID. OK, so what we're interested in is the index. So we want the basically the index. So these are all brewer IDs, and they're ordered by number of reviews, and we'll just take the first 10. So that's what we do for brewer IDs. So these are the 10 most popular brewers, and then we have the 10 most popular beers. And we want to know whether a beer is in the top 10, whether a brewer is in the top 10 brewers, basically. So one way you could do that is, you know, df.brewer ID equal to that first first one, which was what, 35? And then you can do an or df.brewer ID equal to the second one, 140, and then keep going. This would get annoying since you have to do all 10, right? So instead you can use brewer, you can use isin to check if it's in a list or a collection of any kind. And we'll use this in just a second. So isn can also take a dictionary, which I hope this is makes sense, basically. So here, brewer is a data frame, right? Brewer has the brewer ID and beer ID. And we want to know whether, you know, is this value in the brewer IDs? So you can pass it a data frame. You can pass it a dictionary saying, OK, tell me if this brewer ID is in this list of brewer IDs. Tell me if this beer ID is in this list of beer IDs. So that's what we're doing with isn. And we can do that. And typically, you'll need to follow up isn with a, if you're doing it on a data frame, you'll have to follow it up with an any or all. So these are methods on series and data frames. And this is saying, give me the rows from brewer where the brewer ID is in brewer IDs. Our top 10 brewer IDs. And the beer ID is in the top beer IDs. And then I say this dot all columns. And that's saying go across the columns. So let's look at what this actually is here. So this gives us this data frame here. And I want to say dot all of columns. So this is going to go, so this first one will be false because it's not true and true. Okay. And then we select just that subset. So these are top 10 brewers and top 10 beers, selecting that subset. And I think you will possibly use that in the next exercise. So we have one, two, like three or four exercises in a row here. So if you want to get going on those, and if you run into troubles, you know, ask the person next to you, ask me, raise your hand, and I'll try and help you out. So starting off with this first one, finding the beers or the beer styles, either American IPA or Pilsner. Yeah, in this case, we're looking for exact matches, but. Okay.
So,
yes.
Mm-hmm.
That's fine.
You showed us how to select columns, like the label columns.
Yes.
Or the indices of the order of the columns.
Yep.
How can I select all the columns that I have for data frame except a certain column?
Yeah. So if we have DF here, and let's say we want everything but review appearance. Easiest way, a couple ways. There's the dot drop method. And saying just get rid of review appearance. Did I spell that right? And dot drop will drop either index labels or column labels. So axis one or axis equal columns. And I think I spelled it wrong. Review appearance. I also spelled it wrong. Copy paste. And I have a space. I think you can see. Okay, so this now gives me everything except for review appearance. Or if you have like a, you know, a list of columns that you want, you can, you know, select everyone but that column. That's probably the easiest way though. Okay, yeah, in the back. So it's gonna be a copy. And the rules on when data is actually copied, it's a bit confusing since it's using NumPy, and so I'll talk about that at the end of this notebook, actually. But yeah, this will be a copy.
So that might not be a good solution.
If you want to avoid copies.
Mm-hmm.
Potentially, depending on your data size. So there are typically ways around it. And if you just do .loc, that won't copy, usually, depending on the memory layout. But yeah, so that might be better for you there is, you know, if you have df.columns, okay, then drop that review appearance. So df. Dot drop. This is a different drop since this is on the actual columns itself. Drop that. And then do df.loc. That and that. That might be better for you. So select every column in columns except for that one. That'll probably be better for you. Okay. I've lost my place. No, that's where we're at. Any other questions? Okay. So yeah, for this one, I just did the beer style equals American IPA or Pilsner. Okay, and make sure to wrap that in parentheses. Questions on that first one? So these are styles equal to American IPA or Pilsner. So these are finding the exact matches. You could also use stir.contains like Pilsner and IPA. Might give you a slightly different answer depending on how things are named. So now this one, we wanted to find the ones with high reviews for all of the review columns. So we have people rate on appearance, overall, palate, and taste. So the long way is to write each of those out, right? Review appearance greater than or equal to 4, and. Or you can say select the subset review calls. Check if it's greater than or equal to 4. So this will give you a data frame of Booleans. And then do dot all of one, or columns if you prefer. Zero is the rows. If you want to reduce the zero dimension, aggregate over the rows, that's zero. One is sideways columns. It's another NumPy thing. Finally, we have the third exercise here. If you want to, the mean is at least 4 of those 4 columns. It's very similar to the last one. Okay. We select the review columns again. We do the mean first. So before we checked whether it was greater than or equal to 5, we did our comparison, and then we did our kind of our aggregation. In this case, we do our mean first, and then check whether that's greater than or equal to 4. That gives us a Boolean series of Booleans, and then we do our subsetting. All right. There's a few exercises there. OK, hierarchical indexing is a really powerful feature of Pandas. It's one of the more complicated things. So the benefit of what's a hierarchical index first? So what we do is set index is another method on a data frame. It basically lets you shift columns from columns of the data frame to the index. We'll see later on in a later notebook a case where that's even more useful than it is here. But basically, this helps you with doing selection. And what this lets us do is it lets us represent this high-dimensional object in 2 dimensions, basically. So you can think of basically having a dimension for each of these levels of the index is kind of another dimension to this data frame, if you want to think about it like that. But we kind of represent it two-dimensionally here. So that's what we're going to work with. Usually, it's a good idea to have your multi-indexes or all kinds of indexes sorted if you can, especially with multi-indexes, because it helps a lot with performance. And then if you're selecting ranges, you need things to be sorted. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense. So we use this dot sort index method. And what that does is it reorders the rows to be sorted by the index values. And it sorts from outside in, lexicographically. A multi-index is made up of 2 things. So there's levels, and then there's labels. So if we just look at this first level here, so this multi-index has 3 levels. The first level of levels is profile name. And if you look at like this 05 Harley, he has multiple reviews. So there's multiple reviews, but he only shows up once here in the index levels. Okay, so this is unique, but he's represented as an integer 2. And you can see he has quite a few reviews here. So that's just a bit about indices. There's a talk on Sunday, I think, by Jeff Trantner. I'm actually not sure how to say his name, but he's talking a bit about the internals of Pandas. So if you're interested in more about that, you can check it out. I just mention it here because oftentimes you want to do value counts on like a multi-index or a level of a multi-index. And people might call value counts on this and then be confused by why there's only one of everything. It's because that's unique. The actual values are here. So instead of doing value counts on the levels, you'll use this function getLevelValues. So not too important, but people run into it enough that I figured I'd include this here. So if we want to get our top reviewers, basically the idea is we want to basically get the level values for this profile name. So this will give us the names of the people for each review. We do our value counts. Okay, so this counts them up. And then the index will be the name, values will be the number of reviews for that person. Take the top 5 rows and then select the index. So this is these are our top reviewers here. So then the slicing of multi-indexes, the syntax can get a bit tough, but basically this will select the reviews by the top reviewers. And then we also have to include these colons here saying, and then every beer ID and every time. So remember, colon says, just give me everything in that level. Okay. If you want to select subsets of the levels further in, it's even a bit more complicated because this isn't valid syntax. So in this case, we want to select the top reviewers of this particular beer type every time, though. And we just want these columns, right? So this is getting a bit convoluted. And it's also a syntax error because you can't have these colons inside tuples. Python doesn't like that, so we provide this little index slice, which converts it into the tuples that you need. So So this is going to say, okay, give me the top reviewers of this particular beer over all time, and just give me these two columns. So the syntax, I agree, it's not the best, okay, but it's really powerful, and we'll see that in a later notebook. So any questions on that? This is like the hardest thing for me to remember is the slicing syntax. Yeah. So that'd probably be a group by, and we'll get that to that in the next notebook, but that'd be reviews dot group by level equals zero, dot first or dot head one, that'd be it. So we'll see group by in just a second though. Okay, it's good to have a unique index. If you can, it makes slicing a lot less surprising, basically. So pandas, duplicates might slip in for whatever reason. This person posted two reviews at the same time. I'm not really sure how, but he did somehow. So if you, the get duplicates will tell you the labels where that duplicates occurred. And you can kind of see, if you slice with that label there, with those labels, you can see the duplicates, the values there. And if you want to get rid of them, dot duplicated is just a Boolean series. So this is using Boolean indexing again. It's false where it's not duplicated, true where it is. And if you want to get rid of the duplicates, you can do this. Tilde flips a false and a true in a NumPy array. And so if we slice with the non-duplicated values, we get back just the non-duplicated ones, and our index is unique. Okay, so another indexing exercise, select the top beers. So these would be the 10 most popular beers as measured by the number of reviews. Okay, we saw value counts earlier, so. Yeah, so the question was, did I get rid of both the duplicates? And the answer is no. So if you look at this duplicated, you can see I just have a single row here. So remember, duplicated, actually, I'm not going to rerun this because I've already eliminated it. But duplicated returned just a single row. When we sliced with this, so the duplicate occurred here. When we sliced, we had two rows. See that? Duplicated only returns the actual duplicate. So the second one, or the third, however many is duplicated. So when we flipped it, we only kept the first. Okay. And I see here that I've already done the solution for you. I forgot to delete it after running it. So here's the solution, top beers. So we do our get level values on beer ID this time, before we did profile. This time we did it on beer ID. Value counts, take the top 10, and then the index. So these are the actual labels, yeah. Yep, so since I'm calling it on the index here, it's only based on the index. If you're concerned about duplicates in the actual data itself, there's df.duplicated. And then there's also a drop duplicates. So this is for if you're having duplicates in the actual, there's like a select distinct, if you're familiar with SQL. Yes, that's correct. So only the columns, ignoring the index. Correct. OK. Yeah, so then we just slice the top beers here. It's like the beer name, beer style. OK. So before, there's a question about copying, when data is copied. So this is called chained indexing, and it's a very bad thing. You don't want to do chained indexing. So I make a copy of this data, but ignore this copy. This is a different copy than the problem down here. So what we're doing here is we're saying, okay, I want to say that all, change the beer name for IPAs to be yummy, because they taste good. So I select beer styles that contain IPA. So if I just do this, I get back this subset. And then you say, okay, well now I want to select the column beer name, right? So I use my square brackets, and I do that, and everything's fine. And then I say, okay, now I want to actually assign a change to it. And I do that, and I get this big scary warning here saying setting with copy warning. So this comes down to basically NumPy it's the rules are not easy for when you get a view versus when you get a copy of the data. So to be safe, anytime that you're updating a assigning something, which is what we're doing here, having these back-to-back square brackets is bad. That means you're doing chained indexing. Instead, you want to basically change that to a comma and say, select the rows where this is true and just the beer name. And then we make our assignment. And now we can see that our assignment has taken effect. Without that, it was actually not making the change. So sometimes you'll hit this warning even when you're doing things correctly. It's hard to detect, basically. We've done our best, but yeah, so you want to be careful. Any questions on that? So that's just a pain point that a lot of people run into. So when you're trying to update something, but you actually update a copy of the original data, not the original data itself. A lot of times it comes because of this. Okay, yeah. So in this case, it's not. Let's see, let's redo this. So if I do this and then I check, I can see that the update has not taken place. And that's because when I do this part here, it returns a copy and not the original data. Again, it's because of internals that are hard. I don't fully understand them, but NumPy rules basically. So this returns a copy of the original data when you do this chained indexing here. So that does not take place, but when we do this, we get a view to the original thing, and it the update is made. Okay. So if you ever see that warning, it tells you there to use .loc. So, okay. So that's indexing. Yeah. Yes. I mean, usually you don't want to do it because you know if you're just looking at the data, you're going to get a copy, which you may not want, instead of a view, which doesn't copy. And anytime you want to update, you know you're going to definitely not want to do that because your update won't take place. So yeah, typically avoid chained indexing.
Would it still give you the warning if you were storing a copy in a new variable and then updating it on purpose? And if so, is there a way to avoid the warning in that case, or is there a better style to do that?
So you're saying store the copy in a new variable?
See, I just wanted some of the fields or some of the columns out of this and that. And so I was going to, I mean, in this case, it's just thrown away, right? You update a copy that gets.
Yes, thrown away. Yes. Okay. So yes, so that's actually what we're doing here, right? Is we took a copy of the original one. So this bad is what I've called it. So this is a copy of the original one. And so when we do this, you know, DF is still unaffected entirely. And we don't get the warning when we do things correctly. I think that's what your question was.
Well, would you do it that way if you're updating the original, right?
No, so DF is still unchanged, if that makes sense. Yeah, well, I can do the indexing here, but DF is still unchanged. I think that's your question. Because we did explicitly copy it. Okay. So I think we'll move on to group by. Group by is a big topic. We're using the same data for this one, same reviews. Big topic, really useful though. You know, it's going to come up. You're going to want to use it. And the Pandas group by, I think, is pretty nice. The API is pretty nice for doing what you want to do with minimal boilerplate, things like that. So again, we'll read in our beer reviews just like we did before. Want to do some exploratory analysis a bit before we jump into the group by. So there's a few convenient methods. In unique, we can see this is the number of unique beer IDs that were in the data set, number of unique reviewers here. Okay, so in unique just basically counts the number of unique ones. Beer ID, so if we want to get an idea of you know how many reviews were there per beer, so we get the value counts, and then we pass it into this plotting. We'll make a histogram. I did this on log scale. So this is log scale here. So most beers, vast majority, are just reviewed a handful of times. Some are viewed quite a bit more. Brewer ID, so again, similar sort of thing. value counts, and then value counts for the names. And you can see that some people here just have a ton more reviews. Not many, but the distribution here is a lot more skewed out to the right. All right, so some plotting there. And finally, if you want to look at the review overall, remember that's one of their scores. So it goes, you know, on a scale from 1 to 5, half point increments. Most reviews are around 4, and then there's some spread on either side there. Okay, so that's just a little preview of Pandas plotting. There's another plotting library, Seaborn, which is fantastic, and it integrates with Pandas very well. In this case, we do some munging here. Basically, the idea here is we want to make a count plot, so this counts things. The color should be controlled by the kind of review. I'll show you what kind is in a second. And then along the y-axis, you have the number of stars. So it's going to count the number of reviews with that star between 1 and 5. And then plot those counts. And then the data that we pass in is the data frame. We select just review calls. We do dot stack, which I'll talk about in a second. That basically shifts things from the index down into, from the columns down into the index. I'll talk about this in a second, don't worry. Reset index, which we'll talk about in a second also. And then we do some renaming and get this nice looking plot here. So again, I'll talk about those stack and unstack and reset index in a bit. But basically what this is saying is that we can really just focus on one review. The distributions are similar enough that maybe there's not much information on whether we look at review overall versus aroma or whatever. So again, getting a pretty good looking plot in just a few lines of code. And this will make more sense in a minute. Okay, so the basics of group by, there's, you know, three basic steps. Hadley Wickham, who's a R developer, came up with this basically terminology here is split, apply, combine. So basically the idea is you split a table into groups, you apply a function to each group, and then you combine the results of those functions intelligently. So split, apply, combine. And we'll be doing a lot of that in this notebook. Hopefully I don't have to motivate this too much. You're probably familiar of how useful it is to be able to do group bys and analyze each group separately. So won't do too much there. So in Pandas, what this looks like is you have a data frame or series, and you group by a grouper. So this is the first step. Grouper can be a bunch of different things. We're going to be doing a lot of this, a series or a column name, saying group by this column. It can be a function that'll be applied to the index. We won't see this. It can be a dictionary, which groups by its values. We won't see this one either. Or it can be a level in a multi-index, which we will see later. And I showed you that a bit earlier when I found the first review per profile. Okay, so to jump into that, we do this group by, and now we have this object group by, a data frame group by object, which hasn't really done anything yet. We haven't done any computation yet. All we've done is basically some bookkeeping to say, okay, these rows go with this key of this group by. To actually do something, the actual apply and combine, there's a few things you can do. So if we wanted to find the mean of each column by our beer style, which is what we've grouped by, this is what it would look like. We're saying .ag is saying aggregate. So that means one row per group. And what the function I want to aggregate with is mean. So this is the mean of each of these columns per row, per beer style, sorry. So one thing to notice is that we got rid of like the text, the actual text of the review and the beer name. You can't call a mean on text, so non-numeric columns are ignored. And the other thing to notice, actually I'll get to that in a second. So yeah, basically we ignore non-numeric columns, which can be useful. You can also select, so you can do the same sort of get item on group by objects that you can on data frames. So if I want to just get the mean of review columns, I would do it like that. Finally, you can do dot attribute. So I just want this single column. So just like you can select a column of a data frame with the dot. Dot ABV, select just that ABV column, which I don't have there, and then take the mean. And finally, there's a lot of little options here. If you want the mean, you can skip the ag part entirely. So that some of these aggregations are attached directly to the group by object, just since it's convenient. So, and you know, it's obvious, mean is always going to be an aggregation. You're always going to have one row if you're aggregating with mean. So that's the shortest little way you could spell this is. So any questions on the basics of group by? Splits with our grouper, which in this case is beer styles. We apply a function. We've only applied mean. We'll see some more later. And combine, we've just aggregated one row per beer style. Okay, so the exercise here, find the beer styles with the greatest variance or standard deviation in ABV. So which beer styles have the greatest variance there? And I'll give you a couple hints. Any questions? Okay. Yeah.
What if you wanted to apply different aggregations to each of your measures and
then
you
want
to group by?
You can do that. I get to it. I'm not sure if I'll get to that notebook actually. So I'll show you quick. So if you want to group by beer style, we want to aggregate. So ABV, we're going to aggregate with the mean. So I'll just pass you the dictionary saying column two. Yeah, review overall. I'll take the standard deviation. So dictionary of column name to aggregate function. Okay. Hopefully, did I do that again? Oh no, I just had the result. So group by beer style, or you could just use this GR that we've been working with, our group by object. ABV, select that column, take the standard deviation, and then dot order. We sort in descending order to get the highest variance ones. Okay, questions on that? Okay. A halving. So this is that's where you group by first and then do the halving this condition. So basically, what you would do the group by essentially, and then do the Boolean indexing or whatever afterwards. I think that's equivalent. So I think even in SQL, it has to actually do the group by first, right? So yeah, I don't know. I'm trying to think of an example. Yeah, so it'd just be like this intermediate step, we'll call this x or whatever, x of x greater than 2.5. So it's like a group by and then having variance or standard deviation greater than 2.5. Okay. Yeah?
Maybe it's not pertinent into this section, but is it possible to sort of change rows into columns? For example, we have a mean, and then you want to bucketize the mean like 0 to 1, 1 to 4.
Yeah. You can do that. So like this one, right? What you do is pd.cut, I think is what you're asking, to cut it. So the question was, how do you get it basically into bins, I think? So you would cut that and then cut it by, this should work, 5. So this will be all you're saying. That's a lot of missing values. I must have messed something up. You can also pass in bins as well. I'm not sure what I did wrong there. There's probably none in there because it's ABV. So yeah, so you can do that. Does that answer your question? I was just too low, say 3 to 12. I don't know what the highest is here, but those will give you the bins. There's actually categorical, which we I don't think we'll get to. But yes, it's possible. Okay, I think we've done that. So I'm just going to blow through these really quickly. It's kind of showing off how there's a lot of different combinations. So you have what you group by, you have the rows that you're, or the columns that you're doing the operation on, and then you have the actual operations that you do themselves. So there's a lot of combinations there. So you can, so we're still just working with GR, which is our group by beer styles. We select a single column and we do these three aggregations here. So you can pass in functions as well. We've been using strings, but you can pass in functions that work on vectors basically, standard deviation and counts. This returns a data frame. You can do a single aggregation on multiple columns. So again, select our review columns, do just the mean. We saw that one already. You can do multiple aggregations on multiple columns. So we select our review columns and we do three aggregations per column. This gives you back a hierarchical index in the columns. So before we saw hierarchical indices in the actual row labels, now it's in the columns. These can be a bit awkward to work with. I mean, it's fine. You can just select review appearance and it works, just giving you that subset. Or you can stack it. So we saw that briefly before. Basically what that does is it shifts a level of the multi-index or the columns into the index. Okay, so in this case, now we'll have this top row here, this top level of the index shifted down into the index. So now we have a review appearance, review aroma for each beer style. Okay, so that's stack. Again, still going through, there's a lot of combinations. Now we're gonna change what we group by. Yes, we are, sorry. We're just building up a separate data frame here. So what I do is take our group by beer styles, I aggregate, and then I stack. So I have this multi-index, so that's what we saw just up above. And now what I can do is take this multi and group by a level. So now I want to say group by level, select this mean column, and take the min and max. So which beer style has the biggest range in the means of the original four kinds of reviews? Sorry, it's the logic is very nested here, but it's not bad, I think, in Pandas. It's pretty much as cleanly as you can express it. But yeah, this is just showing the range of the reviews, the means of the reviews. Yeah. So you can group by multiple columns, and this will give you a multi-index. Makes sense, right? One row per pair, essentially. So I'll group by brewer ID and beer style, get the review overall, and take the mean. And then very similar to that one, if you do multiple things in the group by, and then select multiple columns, single aggregation, you get back a data frame. And I think that's it. I left off even. There's a few more that you can do, but I figured we'd had enough at this point. So the next little exercise here, this little fun one, plotting the relationship between the length of the reviews, this is something I was just curious about. Do longer reviews, is it because they're more enthusiastic? That's kind of what I suspected. So what's the relationship between review length and then the review overall? Okay, so the average. So this is gonna say, okay, of all the reviews that are one letter long, what was the average review? And then two letters long all the way down. We saw that dot stir namespace. So if you've forgotten, the df.text contains the text of the review. And then we have that stir namespace. So there's a function in here to find the length of each text. And we're gonna group by that. To make the actual plot, I use this. So this can be passed into style, if you want to reproduce this plot exactly. Otherwise, you'll have lines connecting them, which is fine. Any questions as we work on this exercise for the next half minute? Okay. So this one should be df. We're gonna group by df.text.stir.len, okay? So group by the length of the review, and then take the review overall, right? That's the column that we're looking at. And then .mean. So that's the actual thing. And then .plot style equal k dot. We've got our plot there. Okay, so one line, it's a dense line of code, but it's a line of code. And we get our relationship, and see maybe there's a slight positive relationship there. And then the variance of the reviews, right? There's a lot fewer reviews that are this long, so you get a higher, much more noisy once you get out there. Okay. A couple other bonus exercises I think we'll skip, but you can, like stir.count, you can pass in a regular expression. So if you want to count like the number of sentences or something, you could do a regular expression to try and find punctuation, and then group by that. So you can group by pretty much anything. This is what it would look like for, I think this is for the number of words. Okay, and then number of sentences. We're gonna skip over those though. This one, which brewery has the largest gap between the min and max? Review overall for their two beers. Okay. Why don't you take 30 seconds to try and work on this one? Which I would recommend breaking up. Finding the average review overall for each brewer beer name pair. And then do a second group by. I haven't checked on the chat room in a while. Not too much. Type error. This is the thing I don't like about Gitter. They'll automatically substitute emoji, basically, for your code. Shift tab will give you the little doc string. If you're inside a function, so if I do like df.mean, open up the parentheses, shift tab gives you that. And then question mark will bring up the pager at the bottom. Okay, so for this one, load it in here. So we're gonna do it in two parts. We get the average review per brewery, beer name, pair. Select just this review overall and take the mean. And then the extrema, so the min and the max, we're gonna group by the level. So this is our second group by here. Group by the beer ID level. I'll run this first part. So you can see, we group by the index, level, brewer ID. Take the min and max, find the difference, and then put that in descending order. And so what probably happened here is there were like two reviews. One was a 4 and one was a 0. If I had more time, I would show you, you know, you can aggregate the count as well and then do a halving where the count's greater than like 20 or something. Gonna skip that since we're running short on time already. Let's see here. Yes, I'm actually gonna skip this as well. This is, I'll run through it quick, but just very briefly. This beer name or beer style is really granular. So I was thinking maybe kind of get a higher level of categorization here. So I came up with these kinds and then made this fun regular expression here. There's a stir.contains, which will basically look for a regular expression. And once it finds a group, it'll return that, so we can get an idea of a beer kind here, which is a higher level than the beer style, using this stir.extract and then passing in this regular expression. I'm actually going to skip over the rest of this because, yeah, it's a bit messy, but this gives us a higher level of categorization above the beer style. Okay, and I think we'll call that good for that eggs. If you scroll down a bit more, there's transform. So remember the split, apply, combine. We've only done one type of combine so far, and that's just aggregation, one row per group. There are a couple other kinds. There's also transform. Transform will always return a data frame that's the same shape as the thing that was grouped. So one row per everything that went in. It's something it's pretty common. Some people have higher, just like a natural baseline for reviewing. Some people are lower, a little grumpier. So you may want to, subtract the mean to get a more meaningful comparison. So this D mean does that. It just takes the, given a review, an array of reviews, take the mean and subtract that off. So you can apply this to the whole data frame, or you can do it at the person level. So we say group by profile name, transform with D mean, and what that'll do is for each row that we put in, it's gonna subtract it off the mean. So that's useful. Not gonna have time to get to it, but later on I had like a beer recommender. So if you have chance and wanna go through that later, you can do that because if you're doing a recommender, it's a terrible recommender. You don't wanna do this, it's bad, but it was fun. And you'd want to take away the means before comparing two people. But yes, we won't have a chance to get to that right now. Are there any other questions? So that was transform, which returns an identically indexed data frame as what went in. same size. And then there's also apply, which is very flexible. And we'll see an example of that later. So I'll leave that for now. And that's going to close out group by, unless there are any questions. Yes. Yep. Yeah, so the question was, why do I pass in the function here to transform? So it's just a subset of functions that have been defined to basically we'll intercept the string, we'll look up and see mean, yeah, we know how to do mean, and we'll apply the correct mean function, sum, count, size, things like that. In this case, I define dmean myself, so yeah, Pandas doesn't know about it. Yes, question? Yeah, I actually noticed I should have done that. I didn't mean to do it. So if I just do review overall, I'll select it. And then now it's, yeah. Back to the what? If you want to like include this in the original or? So like if I want this, review overall demeaned, I'll just assign it as a column. And now it's in there. I think that was the question. Okay. So now it's at the end here. Okay. Okay. Or you could merge it, and we'll talk about that later. All right. I think that's it for group by. Well, it'll come back. We'll still use it, but I do want to talk about tidy data. So if you move to that fifth notebook, you got about 20 minutes left, I guess, and then questions. So tidy data, second shout out to Hadley Wickham here. This link goes to his paper. I'd definitely recommend reading it. It's an extremely readable paper. I've tried to summarize it here with these rules. So basic idea is, I don't know, the way I like to think about it is, so you know, I have Orwell where if a word doesn't exist for a concept, then you can't think the concept itself. So that's, you know, kind of his idea there. So there's a similar, less dire sort of thing for data analysis is if your data is in the wrong shape, it's going to limit the kind of questions that you can ask, and it's going to limit the kind of answers that you can get to. So tidy data is a way of structuring your data to facilitate analysis. So what shape does my data need to be in for me to answer the questions that I have or come up with new questions that I should be asking that I'm not? The rules of a tidy data set are each variable forms a column, each observation forms a row, and then each table or each observational unit forms a table. We're not going to worry about the third one too much, but the first two are what we're going to deal with here. So the motivating example for this one was a Stack Overflow question where this person had some questions about some NBA games. So Pandas has a function here to read in basically HTML tables. I'll see if this comes up. Yeah, so this is a website with a bunch of data on NBA games, and you can see the table here fairly, you know, well formatted as far as these go. So read HTML was able to handle it very well. Other websites, if they're not as well formatted, you can pass in things like CSS selectors to give it hints of where the correct table's at in the web page, identifiers. Read HTML will always return a list of data frames. So we select off just the first one. There's a second table down below that we ignored. And then I wrote it to a CSV and included that in the repo so we don't have to all try and parse the site at the same time. Read HTML is a neat function. It's my first stop. Anytime I need to scrape data, I try it with read HTML first. If that doesn't work, then you know, break out LXML or Beautiful Soup or something. This is what the data set looks like, and we'll read it in here first. Reading in here, so the column names, read HTML wasn't able to grab those correctly. It's got this some random columns here that it didn't get correctly. There are some duplicated columns on the page itself, so I just pass in my own column names here. Skip the first row since it's messed up. Parse dates, okay, parse the date column as an actual date time. Then we drop, so we saw a drop already. We want to get rid of these columns, don't care about these. not going to use them. And then I shift date over into the index, and I append it to the index. So that's what gives me this game ID, and then the date in the index. So just a bit of wrangling to get this into the shape that, this isn't the shape that we want. That's kind of the problem. So is this a tidy data set? So the question this Stack Overflow person had was, how many days of rest did each team have between each game? So given that question, is our data set tidy? Do we have a single, each column, a single observation per row, and then each variable has its own column. Do we have that here? What do you think? Yes or no? No, of course not. If it was yes, we'd be done, and I wouldn't have included it. So it's not. What's our problem? Or what is an observation here? It's going to be. Yes. So that's the two parts. Is when a date, the team plays. So the pair, team date is an observation. Okay. So we need to get that. To do that, we'll use this melt function. Melts comes straight from one of Hadley's packages, Reshape or Reshape 2, I forget. Straight out of that. So what we want to do here is melt, it takes a data frame, and I pass in this data frame. The data actually wasn't sorted, so I had to make sure, sort the data, and then reset the index. So melt, came straight from R, where they don't use row labels as much. So we need to pass in the index, is the game ID and date as well. So that's what we're passing into melt. And what melt does is you're saying my observations, my values, are spread across two columns. Right now, I have an away team and a home team. I don't care whether they're away or home. So I want to basically melt that down into a single column. I'm going to give that the name team. But I don't want to lose, I have identifiers that go with each observation. So this identifier, game ID, and this date, it goes with each of these. So I don't want to lose those. I want to make sure that those stay attached. So I need this game ID and date to be associated with the Houston Rockets. They played on that day. And I need it to be associated with the LA Lakers, since they also played on that day. So what melt will do is it'll expand the identifier columns to keep that relationship, and it'll melt down the values that are spread across multiple columns into a single one. So this is what our tidy data set looks like. Okay, we have our Houston Rockets, Atlanta Magic, and so the everything works out fine there. I actually think this may be, yeah, I think we lost something. Just because the sorting. I was trying to fix this the other day, but game ID and date. I think we're okay. I'll check on it. Yeah, I think we're okay. Sorry, distracting myself. Anyway, so that's our tidy data set, and then now we can answer our question. So how about for each team, anytime you see for each, it's like a group by. Select the date. I want to know how many days did they have between each game. So I'll just take the date and I'll diff it. What diff does, you haven't seen it yet, but if you have a numeric column like home points here, I can diff it. And what that'll do is take this minus this. It's kind of like the percent change. It'll take the 101 minus the 90, 101 minus the 101, 121 minus 100 and 1, okay, and give you that series. The first one's a NaN missing since there's no prior observation. So that's what we do. I mentioned the .dt namespace, so this returns a, not that, this returns a syntax error. That returns a time deltas, which could be useful. We just want the days, though. So I do .dt.days. This is just like a time delta, a Python time delta. And then we select one since we want the days of rest. Missing values again for the first game for each team, and I assign that to a column in rest, and then to get back to how we were originally, I want to unstack it basically. To do that, we'll do pivot table. It's like an Excel pivot table, that gets us to where we need to be. Questions on that? Can you say that again? Sort?
Yeah, sort the dates before the
Did you ask why do I, or where did I? I did that here. So in sort index, it should have sorted by game ID and then date, which I think happened. I'm slightly concerned because it's not duplicated here, but I think, yeah. Reset index moves, so there's set index, which takes columns and puts them in the index. Reset index takes index and puts them in the columns. Does that make sense? Correct, yeah. And that's just because of melt. It doesn't. There's no way to say use the index for the identifier variables. You can't do that. So that's something we could probably fix in Pandas.
And how would you, if you had also wanted to include that team's points, but you didn't care if it was, likewise, you didn't care if it was away points or home points, you just wanted the team's points, can you get both those values in one?
Yeah, I think that'd be not possible because there's no way to say that you're melting these things together, right?
Yeah,
Yes. Yep. So you'd have to do them separately and then join them, which is what I'm going to do here, actually. Concat is a way of sticking together things. So now we have games, and then we have the away rest and the home rest here. So that's how we would get back, is do them separately. Okay. I'm going to skip this. Seaborn is awesome, and you can do really neat visualizations with just a couple lines of code. Gonna skip it though. Gonna skip this also, since we're running short on time, unfortunately. I'd say check this little project out. It was a fun little thing, basically looking at home court advantage. I did promise you we would talk about, or no, that's in the second notebook. So we'll skip this as well. And if you have time, you might not, but you can go back later and kind of fill this out. And you have the solutions as well. So I'll leave that for you. Basically, doing a little analysis, and then kind of the question here is how do we get it back in here? So that'll answer that question. And then doing a little logistic regression on that to figure out, okay, what's the effect of having home court advantage?
Would the results of melt also sorted, the output from melt also sorted by variable?
So, yeah. The question was, what's the sort order of melt like? I'm actually not sure. So I think it's the same order as what goes in. So it'll be sorted basically by these. So these get expanded as appropriately. Yes, and I think that might be what's happening. And so I'm not sure why this sort didn't work. Yes, that'll do it. Thank you. Okay, so now it looks better. Thank you. I appreciate that. It was very confusing. Okay, so one last notebook I want to get to fairly quickly, we have about 10 minutes left here, is this four stats in it, machine learning. So, Pandas is a great library and all, but you can't go to your boss or your advisor and say, hey, look how clean my, I did this awesome data munging in like 10 lines of code. And they'll look at you and say, okay, what can I do with that? It's like, no, don't you understand? The code's so clean. Yeah, I know. So to actually do something useful, you'd want to get some insight, do some statistical inference or something. So Pandas is kind of the thing that gets you to the point where you can do your analysis. Categoricals, I mentioned them before. We're going to skip them. They're nice for when you have text data with a bunch of repetitions. So in this case, you have bad, neutral, good. There's an implicit ordering there. You can make that more explicit by passing in a categorical. And basically, it's similar to a multi-index where you have kind of categories, and then you have label actual codes there, what we call them. They're integers that go with each one. So categoricals are new in Pandas 0.16, which came out earlier this year. I'm not sure exactly when. Libraries are starting to incorporate them. Patsy, which is a cool library for making design matrices, just added support for them like last week. Seaborn has really good support for categoricals, so they're coming, they're up and coming. And they're really nice for performance. So you can see that we store each category once, and then the codes, and you can store integers more efficiently than these strings. So if you're doing like group by, this might be an example for Dask, is actually, or Blaze, perhaps, too many projects. It's useful to be able to group by codes instead of the string categories. But anyway, we're going to jump past the categories. Get dummies is another useful function. So you know, you can't pass in text to a classifier in scikit-learn, for example. But you can categorize dummy variables, or one-hot encoding is, I think, what scikit-learn calls it. So you can do that. But convenient little function, and we'll skip over that as well. OK, so stats models, I do want to do this example real quick. Basic, if you haven't used stats models before, it's a neat library. And it's got good integration with Pandas. Basic idea is you have estimators, a formula, and a data set. So we'll be doing that. The data set we're working with is looking at CD4 percents on children with HIV, actually. And then, so CD4, it's like a white blood cell, something similar to that. And there's going to be a treatment, antiretroviral viral therapy. So this is, either receiving the treatment is a 1 or 0, you're not. And then it was done in a couple waves. And then we also have the base age and then the date of each application of the treatment, or each checkup, I guess. Blowing through the, summary statistics here, just kind of looking at, we have these two waves of the trial, 1 and 2, and then maybe it looks like ARVs aren't that effective, right? I think a higher CD4 is better. And so you get kind of mixed results here on whether or not it's effective. So one thing that we don't have in this data set is there's probably some dependence. So we're taking multiple observations of the same child. So there's going to be some dependence between the residuals there. So if you just do a regular regression, ignoring that, you're going to lose out on some information. So what we want to do here is add this age column. And that's what this group by does here. So saying I want to group by patient identifier. I want to take the V date. So this is the date of the checkup. And then here's apply. So this is our third way of this is our third step to the group by. There's ag, transform, and apply. Apply is just a general function, and it can do basically anything. So in this case, I want to apply this function. So take the current date, subtract the first date, and then the number of days, divided by 365 to get the number of years. Okay, so that's what this does. And then we add that onto the base age to be, this is going to be basically the age at the time of this checkup. Okay. This is Seaborn again, also a really nice library. Don't have time to talk about it though. Okay, stats models. Nice thing is you can just pass in Pandas data frame. So that's basically the integration there, is you have a formula. You say I want to regress this CD4 percent on these columns in the data frame. This is a little covariance thing for GEE, which we won't go into. You fit it, and then you get a nice summary. And then you can just iterate quickly on that, basically saying, well, what if you have a different covariance structure? Then how do things look? Okay. So that's basically stats models integration. It's nice because you can have just pass data frames right in. We'll skip over that. Very last thing I want to talk about in my last couple minutes here is scikit-learn. So scikit-learn deals with NumPy arrays. It's a fantastic, who went to the scikit-learn tutorial with Jake this morning? Okay, quite a few people. Yeah, so scikit-learn is fantastic. But they deal with NumPy arrays and all of their estimators. So basically when I'm using scikit-learn, I'll have a data frame and then I'll pass in the dot values, which usually works. Values is like a NumPy array. You need to be careful with this because Pandas, can have heterogeneous data, right? That's one of the attractions, but NumPy arrays are only float or, single D type. So make sure your data is ready for scikit-learn basically before you pass that in. And then get your results and then wrap that up in a series or data frame. One nice little thing, did he get to grid search in the tutorial this morning? No. Okay, well, basically, you did see that in a lot of your estimators, you have a hyperparameter that you have to tune to get the best performance out of the predictor, classifier, in this case, regressor. So one easy way to do that is with this grid search CV object. And yeah, this isn't a scikit-learn tutorial, but basically what that returns to you is this list of grid scores. So it's going to go through the Cartesian product of all of these parameters. So these max features, max depth, min sample split for this random forest regressor. It'll go through all the combinations of those, and then it'll give you the basically the value that the score that the predictor got. So this is a nice little thing of Seaborn and Pandas is that you can take these grid scores, you can build a data frame out of them, and then very easily get to a Seaborn factor plot, which makes it easier to visualize the performance of your classifier regressor over the different combinations of hyperparameters. So yeah. So yeah, I think I am officially almost out of time. So that's it. Sorry, I couldn't really have questions at the end there. But yeah, just want to thank. So Pandas, we're always looking for contributors. We are massively overwhelmed in issues. So if you want to, if you're interested in contributing to Pandas, please do. You can find us on GitHub. Again, I want to thank Matera for getting me out here. And then you can follow me on Twitter if you like. We have potentially, well, a minute for questions or so, because I want to get to the next tutorials. I think we have a break. So we'll say 5 minutes for questions, if there are any. No. OK, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yes.
So when would you pick that
I would say always Pandas. They're not the NumPy struct arrays are not the most convenient things to work with, I found. So yeah, I think the Pandas data frame is what most people have settled on for that. Yeah, in the back. All I heard was GeoPandas. What's the plan there?
Yeah.
I don't know. So GeoPandas is they basically subclass the Pandas data frame and then have some cool geo operations on that. I'm not a cartographer, so I'm not sure. I think Kelsey Jordahl is still working on it, though. So it's still being worked on, as far as I know. OK, yeah. Yeah, so Pandas was built when Wes built it. He was working at AQR, which is a financial hedge firm, I think, or quant shop. So it's got fantastic support. I cut out a section on some time series stuff. It's in the notebook if you still want to go look there. It's in the group by notebook about resampling. So it's fantastic for manipulating your data. There's good support for rolling and expanding. Means a bunch of different functions there. Yeah, really good support for that. And then stats models has good time series stuff as well, ARIMA and all that. Okay, so I'll be around the rest of the conference. Feel free to talk to me if you want. And yeah, enjoy. Thank you.